Jesus paid it all. Today I want to share with you some thoughts on that subject, Jesus paid it all, as we celebrate Easter together this morning. And when we think about what Jesus did for us, we think about the cross, we think about the empty tomb, we think about the fact that he is sitting right now at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us. Jesus has done everything he can do to give us life so that we can know love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, so that we can know abundant life and power and strength and overcoming anything that the enemy brings at us and anything that happens to us in this world, that Jesus Christ has given us authority and power over those things through what he did on Calvary's cross and the life and the hope and the peace we have in him. It is truly that abundant life and is that victory that we have in him that we're going to talk about today, because he paid it all. He paid it all so that we could have all that he has in store for us through his word, through his promise, through his power. And one day we'll enjoy eternity forever with him in heaven. Until that time, he's given us promise after promise to bless us and be with us through these times. So today, as we celebrate Easter together, I want to share this word with you, and I want to encourage you today. If you know the Lord as your Savior, these words ought to be encouraging and empowering and enabling. If you don't know the Lord today, this ought to challenge you to want to know him, want to live for him, and want to accept him as your Lord and Savior. And my prayer is today that the Holy Spirit of God would draw you and encourage you and touch your life and heart in such a way that you would want to know him and want to ask him into your heart and into your life today. We're going to be in Philippians chapter 2, and we're going to be in verses 5 through 11. And we're going to share today from this word as we begin this morning and think about what Easter truly means to us in the realm of the fact that Jesus truly paid it all. Philippians chapter 2, verse number 5, "Let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of man. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, and even the death of the cross. Therefore God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." Dear Lord, today I ask you to touch and bless us and help us. God, help us to see something in your word and encourage us by that, God, to know you, to know a better experience in you, and to experience you, Lord God, in all of your fullness and power, and to know life, hope, and peace, and strength and joy in our lives today. We thank you for the cross. We thank you for the empty tomb. And we thank you that today, Lord, you have our backs and you have our lives and our hearts in your hand. And we ask you to bless us and touch us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. When we look at what Paul writes to the Philippian church here, there's some really encouraging things to glean from this and to take from this. And as we look here and we talk about how Jesus came and he made himself of no reputation, and he comes in the form of a bondservant and the likeness of man. He's the Son of God and Son of Man, and all of those things we talk about. It comes down to the place here where we see that he was obedient to the point of death. The Bible says even the death of the cross. Now, we're going to talk here in just a moment about what the cross actually entailed from a medical doctor's standpoint, and how that appeared in some terminology that the doctor shared a number of years ago. But before we do, I want you to think about the shame that goes into this. And this is the point of all this. From the moment Jesus is arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane, they take him to the high priest compound in the dark of the night, which was illegal and wrong for them to do and should not have been able to do that. But they had basically had two trials there in the dark of the night, and they couldn't do anything legally until the morning, and that had to be before the Sanhedrin. But they made up their mind in the night what they were going to do, and even before they got him to the Sanhedrin, they blindfolded him and punched him and hit him and said, "Prophesy, tell us who's hitting you." And they take him into the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin, they try to embarrass him, they try to shame him into stop saying that he's the Son of God and make any claims that have to do with him being Messiah, because they just can't feature how he could possibly be the Messiah, right? So then you go from there, and they take him to Pilate, and Pilate really doesn't want anything to do with this. Pilate's already a man kind of under magnifying glass, and already winds up, looks like he's going to be in trouble. In the end, he does wind up in trouble a number of years later. But Pilate Pilate looks at it and says, well, okay, Herod's in town, and I'm going to send him to Herod. Herod just wants to see a miracle. Herod embarrasses him. Herod sends him back to Pilate. And then Pilate takes him and whips him, beats him, scourges him, and beats him almost, has him beaten almost to death. And Pilate didn't do the beating. It was his soldiers that did that. And these were very skilled people in their job and what they did. And they beat him and abused him almost to the point of death. And by his stripes we are healed, the Bible tells us. And that's from Isaiah chapter 53, the context of that that matters to us today for our salvation and for our atonement, that he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace is upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. And those stripes he received from Pilate's Roman guard, those are the stripes of which we're healed today. And we claim that healing in Jesus' name. Now, the shame and embarrassment that goes with all of that, I mean, it's a horrible, very emasculating, very shameful process. And then they bring him back to Pilate and before the crowd, and the crowd is standing down below, and Jesus has been beaten head to toe almost to the point of death. And then you go into this place where Pilate presents them Barabbas. Barabbas is a criminal. Barabbas is a horrible person, and everybody knew who Barabbas was. And Barabbas was already sentenced to die for his crimes. But Pilate thinks he's got his out. Pilate thinks he's got his opportunity. So he says, I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to release somebody to you. Do you want Barabbas or do you want Jesus? And the crowd, shockingly to Pilate, I believe, says, give us Barabbas. What do you want me to do with Jesus? Crucify him. Crucify him. When it's all said and done, Pilate washes his hands before the people, and Jesus is taken away to be crucified. When you stop and think about everything that transpired in the course of these events, it is about shame, it's about embarrassment, it is about taking him to a place that they want him to know how much hate and disdain they have for him. And as we look today at these details and talk today about what crucifixion actually was and how it actually affected the body, I want you to think and imagine, if you will, that image of Jesus on the cross, whether it's the image from the Passion of the Christ, whether it's the image that you may have from, you know, the Jesus Film Project or some other place that you've seen the story of Jesus Christ, and you've seen him on the cross, whatever image that is, I want you to think, and I want you to imagine this with me today as I share this with you. And this is a medical doctor's description, answer to the question, what is crucifixion? A medical doctor provides a physical description. The cross is placed on the ground, and the exhausted man is quickly thrown backwards with his shoulders against the wood. The legionnaire feels for just the right place to drive the nails. He drives a heavy, square, wrought iron nail through the spot and deep into the wood. Quickly, he moves to the other side and repeats the action. The left foot is pressed backward against the right foot. With both feet extended, toes down, a nail is driven through the arch of each, leaving the knees flexed. The cross is then lifted into place. The victim is now crucified. As he slowly sags down with more weight on the nails than the wrist, excruciating, fiery pain shoots along the fingers, up the arms, and to explode into the brain. The nails in the wrist are putting pressure on the median nerves. As he pushes himself upward to avoid the stretching torment, he places the full weight on the nail through his feet. Again, he feels the searing agony of the nail tearing through the nerves between the bones of his feet. As the arms fatigue, cramps sweep through the muscles, knotting them in deep, relentless, throbbing pain. With these cramps comes the inability to push himself upward to breathe. Air can be drawn into the lungs but not exhaled. He fights to raise himself in order to get even one small breath. Finally, carbon dioxide builds up in the lungs and the bloodstream, and the cramps partially subside. Spasmodically, he's able to push himself upward to exhale and bring in life-giving oxygen. Hours of this limitless pain, cycles of twisting, joint-rending cramps, intermittent asphyxiation, searing pain as tissue is torn from his lacerated back as he moves up and down against the rough timber. Then another agony begins, a deep, crushing pain deep in the chest as a pericardium slowly fills with serum and begins to compress the heart. It is now almost over. The loss of tissue fluids has reached a critical level. The compressed heart is struggling to pump heavy, thick, sluggish blood into the tissues, and the tortured lungs are making a frantic effort to gasp in small gulps of air. He can feel the chill of death creeping through his tissues. Finally, he can allow his body to die. All of this, the Bible records in Mark chapter 15 and verse 25, "Now it was the third hour, and they crucified him." And they crucified him. No greater love, no greater love has ever been shown than what Jesus Christ shown to us on Calvary's cross. And when we realize and understand the power of Jesus' sacrifice and Jesus doing what he did for us, it was about your sin and my sin. The points in time on the cross where we see various things Jesus said. He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do," as they ridiculed him and made fun of him and said, if you truly are the Son of God, throw yourself down. He thirsted in fulfillment of Scripture. And then the final words of Jesus on the cross that are recorded in John chapter 19 in verse number 30. The word says, "So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, 'It is finished.' And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit." Friends, when we hear those words, "It is finished," those words are powerful. Those words are very clear on what they mean. In the Greek language, there it is the word tetelestai, tetelestai. And tetelestai is a Greek word that one definition is that he is saying, "I have done exactly as you have requested. The mission is now accomplished. Jesus paid it all." When you stop and you think about what he did here, he's telling his Father and telling you and I and anybody who's paying attention, "I've done what I came to do. I've fulfilled the mission. I have done the job that I have come to do." Another example of this word tetelestai is an equivalent of the Hebrew word spoken by the high priest, as the high priest would go in to offer the lamb and offer the sacrifice. He would complete his work and complete his duty of that sacrificial lamb, of the Passover lamb, and he would say a word in Hebrew that is the equivalent of that word, tetelestai, "It is finished." Now Jesus, when he hung on the cross, he is the Lamb of God. John introduced him that way. If you'll remember, when we first come into contact with John and Jesus together, we hear John say, "Behold, the Lamb of God." Here Jesus is on the cross of Calvary. He is the Lamb of God, but he's also the high priest. And as the high priest, in that moment, he offers his own blood for the sacrifice. He offers his own blood for the removal of sin, but not an annual event, but a permanent event. The blood of Jesus covers us all for all time throughout this age until the time eternity completely and totally begins. He offered up the perfect sacrifice. He offered up the sacrifice without spot or blemish, which was himself. And in that sacrifice, and in that moment, when he said it is finished, that qualifies very much in the same vein as what the high priest did and how the high priest did his job. And that blood that grants forgiveness, that blood that grants atonement, that blood that pays the price so that sin is dealt with, sin is forgiven. Praise God. In a business sense, that word tetelestai would be used by a business person, and they would stamp that on there just the same way today that we have someone, we pay a bill, somebody stamps on that piece of paper, "Paid" or "Paid in full." And that very same essence of that was exactly what Jesus was dealing with as well, because the debt was paid. The law said that if you commit sin, there is a debt that is owed. And in the old, as we just talked about, in the Old Testament, under the law, the high priest would go in and offer sacrifices for the sins of the nation. And those sacrifices had to be repeated over and over and over and over again. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that debt was paid when Jesus died on Calvary's cross. When Jesus shed his blood, the debt was wiped out, wiped clean, and there is no price for you and I to pay. There is no judgment coming against us except for the fact that we are forgiven in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Can you understand today that what took place on that cross, what took place when Jesus said, "It is finished," He was saying that your salvation is finished. Your hope is complete. Your joy is complete. The love that I have for you has been revealed in all of its fullness through the cross of Calvary. On that hill, so long ago, the blood was shed. His body was torn. And he gave up his life for you and I. He stood in the place of you and of me. And the price was paid for our sin on Calvary's cross. You see, what we know and what we understand from God's word is, for instance, in Colossians chapter 1, verse 13, he has delivered us from the power of darkness, conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Wow. When Jesus said it's finished, this is his declaration that the sins of mankind are fully satisfied, complete, and fulfilled. And this is a far-reaching, all-embracing for every person who'll put their faith in him. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Hallelujah. Friends, we are saved only by the blood of the Lamb. We are saved only through the power of Jesus Christ. We are saved only through what he did for us on Calvary's cross. And today, when you think about this image of these nails, and you think about the image of the crown of thorns that they placed on his head to mock him and shame him and embarrass him further, when you think about what those things that you see on the screen right now, what they mean that Jesus Christ paid the price, and that is the way that Jesus paid the price. It was through those nails. It was through that crown of thorns. It was through the suffering and the bleeding and the dying. It was truly, as Isaiah tells us, and I remind you once again, that he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace is upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Now the cross was awful. The cross was terrible. The cross is humiliating and shameful to Jesus. But that's not the end of the story. That is not the end of God's plan for what Jesus came to do. Because in order for the victory to be complete, he had to do something else. In order for the victory to be complete, he had to do one more thing. In order for him to truly be everything we need him to be, he had to do the other thing he said he was going to do. Was on the third day, he had to rise again. Telling you something today that's incredible and amazing. When you stop and realize what that empty tomb means, the fact that Jesus was victorious over death, hell, and the grave, it is a promise from God to us to know that death doesn't have a hold on us either, that if we put our faith in Jesus Christ, we are victorious over death, hell, and the grave. Can you imagine what it was like on that very first Easter morning as the sun's coming up? Some of the folks are going down to anoint Jesus' body. They're trying to figure out what they're going to do and how they're going to even even get in because the tomb has been sealed by the Roman guard, which that was something that was asked for by the Jews, so they couldn't say that somebody come and stole his body and claim that he had risen again because he said he was going to, praise the Lord. And what just was depicted there in that movie, what that I shared with you just a little clip of, is exactly that. I just wanted you to see that and have that image in your mind of that resurrected Jesus and that the power of that resurrection, that power that life came back into that body who had been so badly beaten and abused and torn and just a shameful way treated terribly. And he died, but here he is alive again, and he's alive, and he's whole, he's complete, because of the plan of the Father, that our salvation is found not in a risen Savior. It's found in a risen Savior, not in a dead God that is somewhere where you could memorialize or go visit his grave or whatever, but in a live, victorious over death, hell, and the grave Savior, friends. And that's a promise from God that is fulfilled only in Jesus Christ. So in Matthew chapter 16, you've got the disciples. And you've got Mary and Martha, and you've got these followers of Jesus who their hearts are still broken, and they're still beside themselves. Now, there is that promise and that hope, and that somebody's been the voice of reason, said, yeah, but he said he's going to rise again on the third day. But they get together, and they go down to see Jesus, and go down to see Jesus' tomb, and they want to go and anoint his body. And in that process, they're concerned who's going to move the stone for us, right? So they get there and the stone is moved. And the stone is moved out of the way. And they go inside and they find a young man sitting there. And he says, the one you're looking for is not here. And I'm paraphrasing this, of course, just bear with me. He says, the one you're looking for is not here. He's risen. And go and tell his disciples and Peter, because more than likely Peter was somewhere else because he didn't want to be around everybody else because he denied Jesus and was ashamed and embarrassed by that. So go tell. So they went and told. And as they told people, they said they heard what they said, they said, but they didn't believe them, right? So then that takes us down to when we get back to Mark chapter 16 and verse 15. And Jesus appears to them, and Jesus shows up on the scene, and Jesus says to them, starting in verse number 15, he says, and go into the world, preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will follow those who believe in my name, and they will cast out demons, and they will speak with new tongues. And they will take up serpents, and if they drink anything deadly, it by no means hurt them. And they will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. That's Mark chapter 16, 15 through 18. Friends, when we recognize and realize the power of what Jesus Christ has done for us through the cross at Calvary, it's about more than heaven. It is about deliverance and strength and healing and his glory being revealed in us here today, where we live right now in this day, in this age, in this hour. And as we think today about the promise of God and what this means to us, we have so much to thank God for and so much to believe God has done for us when you look at what the Word of God teaches and tells us. It's powerful. It's incredible. It's amazing. Jesus truly paid it all. Not just so we can go to heaven, but so we can have life and peace and hope and strength where we live now. Praise God. Praise God. And if you've made your decision for Jesus, that's exciting and it just fills you with passion and power to tell the world. But for those that have not yet made a decision, let me give you hope. Let me give you God's word to lean on. In Romans chapter number 10, verses 9 and 10, the word tells us that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. In verse 13, he goes on to say, for whoever calls in the name of the Lord shall be saved. Neighbor, this morning, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, it is a simple thing to believe Jesus, to believe what I've shared with you this morning about a man who was born of a virgin, lived a sinless life, suffered, bled, and died on Calvary's cross, rose again on the third day, And as we know and understand from Scripture, he rose, he ascended back to heaven, back to the Father, and sitting now at the right hand of the Master, right hand of the Majesty on high, excuse me. And today, we can put our faith and confidence in him that he loves us and cares for us. He has a home in heaven for us, but more importantly, he has blessings for us in the here and now. There's peace, there's strength, there's encouragement. There is the fact that we can know that we're saved. And that comes with what I just read to you and what I just showed you, that if we'll confess them with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God has raised him from the dead, we'll be saved. So let me ask you this morning, have you heard the word have you heard the word ministered and preached? And do you believe today that Jesus Christ died on Calvary's cross for you and rose again? If you'd say, yes, I do, but I've never made that decision, I've never made a commitment, I've never prayed the prayer and ask him into my life, I want right now to share a moment with you and to lead you in a prayer to ask him into your heart and into your life. And I want to pray with you. Would you repeat this prayer after me? Dear Jesus, forgive my sin. I believe what I've heard this morning, that you came, that you lived, that you died, and that you rose again, all for me, so that my sins could be forgiven and that I could have abundant life and have hope and peace and a home in heaven. Thank you that you love me. Help me to walk with you and live for you. In Jesus' name, amen. What I just shared with you just a moment ago confirms that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, you're saved. And this morning, if you confess the Lord Jesus, as we just did, you're saved. Your name is written down in heaven. The Bible tells us there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels when one sinner is saved, one sinner repents. Thank God this morning that you made that decision, and I hope that you'll understand that as you begin to read God's word and worship him and honor him for who he is, that your life and your strength and everything that you need is in him, and the power is in him, and the strength is in him. And today, what a joy and what a privilege it is to know the Lord and to have a life and a hope in him. Praise God. Praise God. We rejoice with you this morning. I would ask you to contact us. There is a email address on the bottom of the screen, ctagpastor@gmail.com. If you'll let us know that you prayed that prayer with me this morning, it would be so exciting to us and so thrilling to us. You can visit our website for more information and things about our church and our church family, and that's at www.ctaghiawatha.com. And we'd love to hear from you and love to have you make contact with us. There's contact information there. Our location for once we're back to having a normal church, hopefully in a few more weeks into May, we'll be able to have church in the normal fashion. And you can join us here if you live in the area. We'd love to have you.